please join me in welcoming Professor Antoine.
I'm happy to adopt the protocols before me. Good evening, everyone. I don't normally read, but the topic is so broad that I had to contain it in reading my lecture, which I prepared. This evening, I want to offer reflections on the role of the judge in a modern, still young nation attempting to deepen its democracy and pursue appropriate paths to development. Actually, I'm responding to questions posed by an actual judge about his role, who worried, is there something more? What about responsiveness to the lived situations of the people? Leadership around central constitutional and legal principles? What about inspiration, buy-in around core legal values? Inspired by those questions and transposing my own multidisciplinary understanding of law, I frame the issue in a theoretical construct which looks at it from the point of view of the rule of law, and I came up with the topic, rule of law versus ruling by laws in the quest for development. But is there really a dichotomy between the rule of law and ruling by laws, as my title supposes? What I want to suggest is a difference between a mechanical application of legal rules and law that is contextually applied. I'm not speaking of anarchy. A society needs laws, identifiable laws. There can be no rule of law without them. Equally, however, modern concepts of the rule of law mean more than merely ensuring that these laws are in fact applied in a particular society. There must, in addition, be equality of the law, and increasingly there is a demand that, quite simply, the law itself must be just for it to have legitimacy. I see also this well-known but sometimes nebulous concept of the rule of law as firmly centered in development, such that judges cannot be divorced from these larger socioeconomic issues of development when making decisions. In the background of my attempt to frame an adequate response to these questions, there's always a tension between judicial activism and the legitimate role of the legislature, since judges, we know, or we are told, only interpret law. They don't make law. I concede that the danger in this exercise will always be that point where purposive judicial making becomes judicial dictatorship, which ignores or frustrates the legislative imperatives of the democratically elected representatives of the people. So it's a Herculean task. And I have no doubt, although it's a fascinating subject, I think, that the lawyers in particular, schooled as we are in the language and the logic of conservatism, would find it controversial. What, therefore, are the imperatives for development that the law, the judge, must take into account in a developing democracy? More so, one that is pluralistic and outward-looking. In today's context, we cannot escape a conversation about economic, social, and cultural rights, and how these must intertwine with civil and political rights. But are there other doctrinal positions and principles that must inform the law in this discussion? The concern of judges that it might not be enough to merely apply rules mechanically without responding to the lived situations of the people and the socioeconomic context that are the boundaries of legal disputes is real and must be addressed. Law, even the Constitution, does not and cannot always give us ready-made answers. So it is left up to the jurist to discern from the elemental values and norms that underpin the law and our democracy if the judicial system is to have legitimacy and meaning. It is the authority for and the pathway toward discovering these grand norms that we discuss today. This is the platform for deciphering the concept of a rule of law and related doctrines in the search for the invisible hand that guides our constitution and legal system. The citizenry, too, unschooled in these deeper understandings of the rule of law, are shy of challenging laws which explore these important questions of our democracy and give the judiciary too few opportunities to interrogate them. We ask, therefore, what cogent, coherent principles currently exist in our legal stratosphere to adequately address or challenge developmental issues that offend the precepts of the rule of law, or can be uncovered from existing law to help further a developmental agenda appropriate for our needs. The slant of this rule of law discussion, framing it within the context of development, brings to bear, I think, cutting-edge questions about the breadth of rights, governance principles, and troubling questions such as the impact of poverty and corruption, both impacted by the failure of the rule of law and restricting development. Goldstone tells us that the absence of the rule of law has accounted for, quote, disproportionately high percentages of the developing world's poor and uneducated. In advanced economies, too, those portions of the population denied access to justice suffer from higher levels of discrimination in education and other public services, unquote. The contribution of the rule of law to sustainable development, poverty reduction, citizen security, human rights, and empowerment is undeniable. The rule of law is therefore, in my view, a gateway to rights and a right in of itself. But what exactly do we mean? It refers to the higher authoritative normative principles that must inform our laws and legal system if they are to have validity. These underlying fundamental legal precepts, which shape and preserve our democracy and society, which are often unwritten but no less compelling. Indeed, so intrinsic are they that they do not need to be written down. There are clearly procedural aspects of the rule, such as due process, but there is increasing recognition that the rule of law also contains substantive elements. I join with Lord Bingham, Marshall, and others, and wholly embrace this substantive dimension. It is this vision of the rule of law that informs my people. Our own Justice Ramada, in the Section 34 case, let's call it that, while agreeing that the rule of law was part of due process, felt that it was not constrained by it. So the content of the rule of law concept, which speaks to notions of procedural justice, is largely uncontested. Further, its concepts such as due process, access to law, equal protection of the law, and natural justice, all of them are used interchangeably, by the way, have been elaborately explored by the courts and are well established. As I wrote a long time ago, the Constitution is a source for procedural fairness called due process or protection of the law. This notion, in turn, is to be viewed as an aspect of the rule of law. However, these fundamental concepts do not originate from the Constitution. Rather, they are reaffirmed in the written constitutions. They are principles which ground the very character of the law and legal system. Due process, in particular, has received really detailed recognition. In Thomas and Batiste, for example, Lord Millet said that it invokes the concept of law itself and universally accepted standards of justice observed by civilized nations which observe the rule of law. The fact that procedural elements of the rule of law are often contained only in the preambles to constitutions has not deterred courts from holding them to be instrumental. Previously, there was a reluctance, as many of you know, in our constitutional jurisprudence to treat preambles as justiciable or enforceable. We saw this in the cases like Campbell, Rodrigues, and others, a reservation which, thankfully, is now discredited. Consequently, procedural justice is treated by both the CCJ and the Privy Council as being an inherent part of the rule of law and intrinsic to adjudication. Its existence does not depend, therefore, on a specific provision in the Constitution, preamble or otherwise. So we need not detain ourselves any further on this point. Judges are well aware of the authority given to them under the principles of procedural justice, and they apply it with gusto. What remains to be interrogated, I think, is whether judges, aided by the citizenry who fail to ask the right questions, have instituted self-imposed limits with regard to the scope and the breadth of procedural justice within the corners of the rule of law. Even the narrowest procedural prescriptions of the rule pose some interesting questions to us in terms of possibilities. The requirements for access to the law and equal application of the law, for instance, are not trite requirements, especially when we consider developmental concerns and economic, social, and cultural rights, let's call them ESD rights because that's a big mouthful, that often accompany them. For example, having the law proclaim an entitlement to education, clearly a developmental objective, seems simple enough. However, in considering rights to education, core principles of equality before the law would need to be included. Where are the schools allocated, for example? What should the judge do if these schools are unevenly resourced so that rural communities are continually underserved? I had cause to write on this recently in the Express after seeing yet another group of mothers and crying children kneeling on my television, lamenting about this. What if these rural areas house children mainly of one ethnic group? A ruling by laws approach will hold that the state has breached no law since it has provided schools. A rule of law approach might yield another result, given the equality and access dimensions of this issue. We can make the problem even more complex. What if the school is bright and shiny with impressive resources, but it is located far away from a low-income community and there are no buses or accessible transport services? What if persons over 50 years of age are excluded? These scenarios may frustrate not only the developmental agenda, but the very rule of law upon which it is based. Similar issues arise with health or housing, where we place hospitals or build buildings without access for persons with disabilities. I see two of my colleagues here who are champions of disability rights. There may be hidden issues of discrimination, what we call structural discrimination, for example, or indirect discrimination, or de facto inequality, which, if challenged and viewed within the lens of the rule of law, may reveal unequal application of law and policy. As one frustrated mother complained to a hugely unsympathetic public when she received a free house but had no transport to send her children to school because of where it was located, that making sense? Intuitively, she realized that equal access to education for her children had been undermined and recognized too that education was a more effective long-term strategy for getting out of poverty. As a society, we have been afraid to confront these subtexts of gender, race, class, and the like, to discern how they impact on our understanding of equality, how they inform our bread and butter issues, ESC writes. Structural discrimination does not depend on an intention to discriminate, but it looks at the impact of superficially neutral paradigms. If development is lopsided or inherently unequal, then it offends the rule of law. While we have acclaimed the general principle of equality before the law, we have not gone far enough in evaluating and discerning the true meaning and depth of such concepts, handicapped by a myopic vision of direct intentioned discrimination. And that is a result of an old case, Smith, which we are still stuck in our psyche, although we have gotten over that case, but somehow it's there still. Yet it is when we begin to identify the substantive content of the concept of the rule of law that we encounter difficult intellectual and jurisprudential challenges, as opposed to mere willful blindness. First, what exactly comprises this substantive dimension? which may or may not be written down, but which judges must consider, and who determines what they are. In this higher construct of the rule of law, rules must conform to acceptable standards of justice before we can consider them to have legitimacy, to be law. Sometimes this notion is linked to morality in the sense of reason, and it suggests too that we have a duty to obey the law only if it conforms to the rule of law. Often I give my students the example of the Nazi laws or apartheid, or of course, slavery laws. These were all legitimized by the relevant parliaments as legal rules, and at points in time, they were in fact obeyed. But did those laws have validity? The people have believed, or may have believed, that they were simply obeying the law, yet today they can be brought before international courts, for example, on claims that they have committed crimes against humanity or genocide, for legal violations which are based on a higher moral order. Today, this notion of morality in the law is conveniently, more often than not, expressed in terms of fundamental human rights, not all of which may be articulated into written law. Even Lord Bingham described it thus, viewing fundamental rights as the fourth subset of the rule of law. These rights intersect with and are supported by an international recognition of rights or democratic values that are seemingly universally shared, another subset of his rule of law construct, incidentally. Development can mean many things, but as a legal scholar, I have always embraced the philosophy of Nobel laureate Amartya Sen's vision of development, which is not only in sync with but dependent on human rights, that human rights enhances and does not diminish tangible economic development. There is a recognition that even here, the concept is not static. And it is in this sense that I emphasize today, for example, when we think of the human rights that undergird the concept of the rule of law, that we are not limited to civil and political rights, and that economic, social, and cultural rights have emerged as important contenders and seen as tangible and attainable. And I make the assumption that our foundational document already encompasses the required core values sufficient for the rule of law, if only we are willing to uncover it. And of course, ultimately, the rule of law is really a recognition and a reminder of these core values that we must continually acclaim, even if not elaborated upon in the constitutional document. I believe that we have not applied or utilized our constitutional documents to their fullest potential. Rather, we have self-restricted them in a variety of ways, including the savings law clauses, the previously narrow treatment of the preambles, which actually contain some of the most important rights, the restrictive interpretation of core concepts such as equality, liberty, privacy, the exclusion of ESC rights, and by viewing rights as compartmentalized and hierarchical instead of indivisible. None of this timidity that we have transported into our constitutions, however, has permanently damaged its basic essence and strength, and we can, without looking back, continue to unveil its magic and beauty. By way of example, the right to liberty enshrined in our Constitution, a core element of the rule of law, has been seen in narrow terms to mean liberty in a physical sense, not to be detained, part of due process, etc. In contrast, in US and Canadian jurisprudence, the latter upon which our own Bill of Rights was based, liberty has a more expansive and abstract interpretation to encompass the right, quote, to contract, to engage in any of the common occupations of life, to acquire useful knowledge, etc. That's from a case, by the way. More recently, it has been famously used as doctrinal justification for expansive concepts of liberty deriving from it the right to privacy, under the parameters of the rule of law in the US to support the defining momentous decision in Roe v. Wade. If you're listening to CNN, you know what Roe v. Wade is about. Pro-choice rights in the abortion debate. In our ruling by laws approach, we have focused only on its negative expression, the things not to do, instead of its positive, abstract, and more substantive character. To cite Roth, in a constitution for a free people, there can be no doubt that the meaning of liberty must be broad indeed. Suppose the state were to decide that boys from Laventille are troublemakers and decrees that all Laventille boys will be taken into foster care by decent families, since mothers are making poor choices, in order to straighten them up and prevent them from lives of crime. So we pass a law, the Protection of Young Males in Laventille Act. And this is not so far-fetched, by the way. Not long ago, we had Aborigines, Indigenous children in Australia and Canada, respectively, who were taken from their families very much the same way. In our current narrow prisms of equality, we would be hard-pressed to challenge such laws. But were we to unleash the full force of a rule of law approach that emphasizes genuine equality, the judge could make a difference. Similarly, equality before the law and the protection of the law concepts, again which we borrowed from Canada, have been interpreted much more expansively there. Our judges have not embraced equality in its fullest sense, to go beyond formal equality. Treating those who are not identical in like ways only perpetuates and deepens inequality. Our writers and our judges have typically sought to truncate the meaning of equality on the rather presumptuous assumption that our founding fathers could only have meant to secure the common law Dicean notion of equality akin to due process. The true meaning, breadth, and scope of equality as a substantive right in of itself is hardly, if ever, explored. Again, in contrast, in US law, expansive notions of equality are applied with a consequent high threshold required to abridge it. Under this rubric, certain rights that are not even stated in the US Constitution have been declared fundamental. For example, recently, the right of same-sex couples to marry. In Canada, the same thing. We can look at the case of Halpern, for example. When I distill these core substantive precepts that make up the rule of law, therefore, I put forward ideas that I want to prioritize as constituting notions of genuine justice in my basket of rights, which we have acknowledged fall within the frame of the rule of law. And they include the principle of genuine equality, as I just described, in an expansive way, inherent dignity and worth, economic, social, and cultural rights, liberty in the abstract sense, sovereignty, and self-determination. And I'll explore that later. To the extent that executive action and rules can be seen to conflict with discernible, substantive core principles of our democracy, the judge has a duty to act to protect them. This is clearly risky, and the only justification for it can be that these core principles are indeed part of the Constitution, though written or not, unwritten, sorry, or not explicit. In accepting upfront the legitimacy and justiciability of ESC rights, I embrace further the indivisibility of rights, which sees civil and economic rights and economic, social, and cultural rights as not only inextricably linked, but indispensable to each other. And to take the broadest example, the question of the death penalty and the right to life. Can we ignore deep inequities in our society that demonstrates a clear pattern of who is on death row? The little black boy. As I have said before, they were not born this way. These are social constructs. Few countries in the region, and Belize, Guyana, and Grenada are exceptions, have specifically highlighted ESC rights in their constitutions, but this does not mean that they are absent from our foundational instruments. They can exist as extensions of civil and political rights, a jurisprudential development which originated in the Indian courts, or standalone rights deeply embedded in our constitutions, which give our laws life and meaning. In my frame of reference, I am particularly wedded not only to the now more traditional manifestations of these rights, like education, health, and work, but also, and you heard I was a gardener, rights to the environment and the right to water, to which we hardly ever talk about. An interesting question for me in the context of the rule of law is whether collective rights should trump individual rights in the development agenda. We have often tended to prioritize individualistic conceptions of rights, but it is arguably the exact opposite that is necessary for development. Collective rights being strong threads which hold the nation state together. Are there limits to a developmental agenda in favor of property rights, which have often been held sacrosanct? We see possible limits to this in the basic structure doctrine, which sees constitutions as containing basic principles that cannot be eroded, even where there's constitutional reform. Again, the Indian courts have led the way. Unfortunately, the doctrine has typically operated to frustrate progressive developmental agendas, engendering radical positive social change. For example, when Indira Gandhi attempted to abolish the caste system, or to achieve equitable based land reform when elite classes hold the majority of land. And I think we see the same thing happening in Zimbabwe. The courts here have ruled in favor of individual property rights, which they saw as unalterable, therefore upholding not simply the status quo, but unequal social and power structures. From my vantage point, it is an unsatisfactory application of the rule of law and undermines my premise that the rule of law must serve the common good, not further narrow individual interests. Here, the legitimate laws of the sovereign appropriately authorized have been struck down. So it is certainly not ruling by laws. However, if we accept that the rule of law must result in more, not less justice, the result seems unjust, at least to those in the society wanting genuine equity. And here it was the state itself in its developmental agenda seeking to enlarge justice and equality and the rule of law, but narrow individualistic notions of rights were used as a weapon to deny the more generous interpretations of these core concepts of the rule of law. In similar vein are these property cases in Caribbean jurisprudence, where attempts were made to envision salaries, pensions as property rights, and the courts have refused to acknowledge the claims because of the public interest, including during the 8% cut in Barbados, structural adjustment, King and the Queen, and of course Trinidad had its own COLA cut in the 1980s, and there was a similar case in Dominica. Such courts have been criticized as having weaker forms of judicial review in the face of socioeconomic policies. But had the conflict been expressed in terms of that between collective rights and individual rights, we may well have understood it differently. It is useful to recall that our notion of property rights is based on Anglo-Saxon, even imperialistic ideals, born out of the feudal system, and is not universal. For indigenous peoples, some African societies, and so on, property rights are inherently communal. Many will know of the deep philosophical clashes in property law jurisprudence when the humble chattel house was declared a fixture in land law and therefore legally owned by the white ex-slave master landowner, by judges disconnected with the context of property in the West Indies. These were judges unfamiliar with the history and struggles of the former slave, now the landless poor, who had to literally carry his house on his back. The right to unhindered access to property was also not upheld when the Jamaican government imposed a poll tax for a road in Campbell Rodrigues. What is the process by which the substantive content is to be created and discovered, the rule of law concept? There's a recognition not only that law must be based on the agreed values of the society, but that it should serve its society. I like to think of this as a social contract in the Rousseau sense, the agreement that each citizen makes to secure the core elements of justice in the society. So if we were to imagine that we did not know where we were to be placed in that society before we were born, whether rich, poor, what ethnicity or gender, what is the minimum content of rights that will secure justice to all? In foresight, the appellant unsuccessfully sought legal validation for the utilization of ganja as a sacrament of the Rasta faith. He argued that defining all marijuana possession as criminal must cause ordinary people to lose respect for the law, that a law is valuable not because it is the law, but because there is right in it, and laws should be like clothes. The laws should be tailored to fit the people they are meant to serve. This must also mean that the substantive principles embodying the concept may not be identical among societies. Despite the fact that universal principles dictate a high level of conformity, in this way, I therefore recognize and underscore the indigenous aspects of the rule of law in any society, our own inner rule of law, which I believe are not only vital to its proper functioning, but is an imperative in the developmental issues that arise in a post-colonial third world nation striving for equity for its peoples and as a nation. Incidentally, the whole question of the marijuana laws, they do operate unequally, and that is very topical and also a question of development. So the rule of law content might not, in fact, be universal. Each society will have variants of it. Since we always need to have British jurists validate our ideas, I note that no less a person than Lord Bingham, in his treatise on the rule of law, which asserts 8 sub-rules of the rule of law, concedes this. He saw human rights principles as part of the rule of law and admits that there is not, after all, a standard of human rights universally agreed among civilized nations. We may regret the United States Supreme Court's decision upholding the imposition of capital punishment for a murder committed at the age of 16, but different countries take different views on the morality of the death penalty. That wasn't me, that was Lord Bingham. He continued, there is an element of vagueness about the content of this sub-rule, since the outer edges of fundamental human rights are not clear-cut. But within a given state, there will ordinarily be a measure of agreement on where the lines are to be drawn. And in the last resort, the courts are there to draw them. The rule of law must surely require legal protection of such human rights which within that society are seen as fundamental. Actually, this is a point I've been making from 20 years ago, though it has not been well received. I have even accused the so-called concept of universalism as hijacking our constitutions by moving away from the internal logic of the constitution and towards more external expressions of justice. What should be the source? I challenge the notion that our sovereign bills of rights were intended to be mere mimics of universal human rights instruments or common law without room for deviation. Our interpretations of our constitutions, which seem so far removed from their original objectives, any less imperialistic than colonial laws imposed on us? it has not escaped my notice, for example, that our understanding of religious pluralism and the consequent right to religion and non-discrimination has, particularly in recent times, well, actually since 9/11, been more generous than in the so-called developed world. Think Moraine, the hijab case, think the Trinity Cross case, think the recent one of the Equal Opportunities Commission, I see the director there, about the right to wear Muslim headdress, a right that has slowly dwindled in Europe and even the US. While we are by no means a rainbow country, and Trinidad is not a paradise, there is a large amount of religious and ethnic tolerance, perhaps born out of a shared sense of suffering among plural groups. What the court here recognized was religious tolerance, an aspect of equality, and a core value of the rule of law. And even the Privy Council often recognizes the value of local circumstances in their cases. Certainly, a constitution is a document which should embody the particular philosophy and even the ideology of the state and its people, even if they appear different to other people. Against this must be balanced the need for the constitution to avoid atrophy, for the constitution is not sterile, but an organic and living thing. But the change envisaged is to respond to the changing needs of the people it governs and not some alien audience. In my view, the direction to interpret constitutions purposively in our struggle to find the true meaning of our constitutions means more than merely stretching the literal meaning of the word. I believe that it speaks to finding the fundamental values, norms, and aspirations of the constitution, its raison d'etre, those grounding principles that our founding parents were thinking of that would give law substance and would finally confirm the capacity of a free people to determine their own destiny in a way consonant with justice. Ultimately, to identify the content of the rule of law, its core values and underlying precepts, the state must have undergone a democratic process to identify its framing legal instrument, the Constitution. This leads to another conundrum. Does the fact that our laws, and to some extent our constitutions, were imposed on us nullify this expectation? For the Constitution to reflect the society's core values, there must be people's ownership of that social contract. Consensus on its governing principles. And if the Constitution does not come from and represent the people, its content cannot be said to be valid. It becomes a poor custodian of the rule of law. While the principles of the law may not be clearly articulated in the Constitution, it is a creature of the Constitution. And if we accept that the rule of law contains principles which conform to the ideas and aspirations of the society, this presupposes that the Constitution reflects these ideas and aspirations. This may present a dilemma to ex-colonial people like ourselves. It is fashionable today to argue that the Constitution is an alien document and that we did not meaningfully participate in its creation, even the 1976 one, as should the citizens of a democratic nation. I recall last year's presentation, whose constitution? Indeed, I used to argue this too. I was one of the first, perhaps, way a long time ago, considering the way in which the Constitution process occurred. But now I apologize. Because in my more mature years, which is now, by the way, I'm looking a little young, but getting old, I have revisited my view of the Constitution, and more so the very act of creating independent constitutions. I now believe that we have placed too little store on what the making of our independent constitutions symbolized for our newly independent peoples. Regardless of what words or principles are expressly written into the Constitution, given that we accept that the rule of law transcends the written word, I now believe that there are indeed fundamental ideas embodied in our social contract at the point at which we created those constitutions, which make up some of the content of the rule of law as understood in our nations. I recognize now that viewing our constitutions so ungenerously ignores the historical reality of the struggle for liberty that grounds the very existence of our constitution. Our constitution, our very independence, were really not handed to us on a platter, even if the British were tired of us. Viewing them as such denies the recognition of the will of our peoples in their striving to be free, and the premium value those that came before us placed on liberty and equality. Rather, they are the culminations of tremendous struggles which must not be invisibilized. In this sense, the Constitution is indeed revolutionary and not merely evolutionary, even if only in its symbolism. Some of these underlying legal principles might be intuitive to the people, not the judges, the people I'm talking about now. For example, liberty in the manner that I discussed previously seems to me to be a profoundly fundamental principle for us. I disagree entirely with Raz, the jurist, who thought that the rule of law could obtain even in the face of slavery, he said, since he saw the rule of law concept as only one of legal formalism. This could certainly not be the case in a region such as ours, with its permanent scars of slavery and colonialism and the social contract that we made at the advent of the Independence Constitution, which places a premium on liberty in all its forms. Undoubtedly, every CARICOM citizen intuitively understands that our constitutions must vigorously protect this, whether explicitly written or not. In Maya Leaders Alliance, the CCJ seemed to be influenced by these notions of liberty when it called for an innovative approach, referring to the centuries of oppression of the Mayan people and the marginalization of their culture. The case is even more remarkable, given that it concerned the failure of the state to act, that is, examining omissions by the state, instead of only actions from legal rules, thereby instituting a proactive duty on the state. It is these foundational principles of liberty and dignity central to the rule of law, demonstrating also the perverse meanings of property in slave laws that Caribbean peoples will have to rely on for the reparations cases on the horizon. And by the way, they are coming, eh? In similar vein, I understood the outcry against spying in the SSA debate as an intuitive understanding that this was wrong primordial invasions of our very liberty and dignity, despite being told erroneously that there was no formal protection of privacy. Elsewhere, we are witnessing a pushback toward these core principles of liberty, even in the face of aggressive justifications for violations of rights, such as terrorism and national security. For example, the US court stood up against the executive to refuse compelling Apple iPhone, do I have it right? Yes, Apple iPhone, to break its encrypting systems, flying in the face of decades of case law with weak protections of privacy. The court saw this as going to the heart of democracy itself, fundamental rule of law ideals, which preserve the liberty of the individual. The EU Court on Human Rights as well, in cases from the UK, which challenged legislation, by the way, almost identical to our SSA legislation, they kept striking it down, they struck it down, promoting routine surveillance for security reasons, and they came to similar conclusions. From the defining concept of liberty, I derive another core value that I believe is part of the rule of law and key to every democracy, and that is sovereignty and self-determination. These are not concepts that we normally talk about in courts, but they are concepts that not only speak to development, but they go to the preservation of the state itself. Yet in the developmental agenda, the courts and the state are often called upon to make difficult choices that could compromise our very sovereignty, although it is rarely acknowledged. A case that always gives me pause, and which I believe belongs in this arena, is Cable and Wireless and Maupin. I don't think you call them Cable and Wireless here anymore. A decision from Dominica, and one of the early and indeed few cases challenging the monopoly that Cable and Wireless enjoyed in our telecommunications space. This case went to the Privy Council sitting in London, which, given the fact that Cable and Wireless is a UK company, brings the issue into focus. In fact, the Privy Council identified prima facie a violation of the freedom of expression, but balked at the application of the proportionality doctrine, so they sent it back to the lower courts. In effect, they refused to give a final decision. The fight in Sandusha, by the way, was the one where we opened up the telecommunications industry, but not through the courts. And it's still of interest in Jamaica. That same battle is now being fought again in Jamaica. What better justification for a CCJ? A court firmly loyal to our region and its development. In this instance, it was difficult to even achieve ruling by laws, far less the rule of law. We had a hint of these underlying concerns in BCB holdings concerning huge tax concessions given to a foreign investor in Belize. This is a CCJ case. In fact, sovereignty was specifically mentioned as a core constitutional principle. I believe it was Justice Witt, who I see here, an aspect of the rule of law by the CCJ. At the extreme end, the principle mandates that Parliament cannot make a law that will sell our birthright, declare us unindependent, or fundamentally destroy our independent constitutions. This will surely require some sort of revolutionary change. Our judges may never be called upon to consider such laws, but many developmental questions come close to this terrain, and I suggest require the judge to consider appropriately questions of sovereignty and self-determination as underlying principles of the rule of law, at the very least under the rubric of dignity, equality, and the public interest. Consider some likely scenarios: privatizing the beaches, waiving labor laws for foreign investment, selling or giving away huge tracts of land to foreign investors, foreign investments that are shown to destroy large parts of the country, tourism with too generous concessions, privatizing water sources in ways that will deprive sectors of the society, monopolizing telecommunications and telephones, as I've mentioned, FATCA. I didn't say that right. In such scenarios, are judges to hold their hands up in despair, powerless and subservient to the executive power, even in the face of ignoring the will of the people? Will that be the rule of law? Caribbean peoples expect their law, legal systems, and if that fails, their judges to protect them in their developmental aspirations. They do not expect the judge's role to be frustrated because of too narrow construction of what the rule of law means. And in my view, our constitutions already include within them these foundational values for true development, some of which I've described. So reading law in barren ways to exclude these deep values and assumptions and aspirations that live in our law, sometimes deeply embedded, sometimes springing to the surface, does our law and our people a great injustice. In truth, it is a self-constructed prison. Indeed, in some ways, the people have surged ahead of the courts, which have been slow to catch up. Just like regional integration, the people already know what rights mean. They claim these rights every single day with the utmost indignation. Often I say that everything in the Caribbean is a right. People think everything is a right. More and more public-spirited citizens, like in the Dimas case, and that is seen as a route to participatory democracy, sustaining the rule of law in the court, are searching for these rights and values. Despite legislation imposing some of the most draconian laws against freedom of assembly, such as the Public Order Acts, they take to the streets at the drop of a hat to protest. Compulsory arbitration undermines strikes, but can do nothing against ghost laws, even for the police. While English law denied us our chattel houses, it has been forced to accept a well-developed system of squatters' rights, sometimes the best real estate. After decades of slavery, the people sense a larger freedom, liberty owed to them than our courts have been prepared to claim from laws that have given the promise, but not always clear directions from the pen. Despite vagrancy laws, we continue to lime on the streets, in blockos, selling on pavements, even driving on the shoulders, confirming and claiming our physical spaces. The people proclaim, "Da beach is mine," that's Gabby. "The road is to walk on Carnival Day," as they assert de facto sovereignty and liberty. In the same way that the cultural values embedded in the maxim, "An Englishman's home is his castle," translates into deep, unwritten notions of privacy in the home in the common law, our own cultural and sociological values can and must inform our inner rule of law. And while I'm not advocating lawlessness, although it might seem that way, the point here is that law must be responsive to the legitimate needs, values, and dignity of a people if it is to avoid being alien, be obeyed, have validity, and truly subscribe to the rule of law. The judiciary must now reclaim our constitutions. The people may have already done so, and they are becoming impatient. Our version of self-determination and sovereignty is also inextricably bound up with our vision of ourselves as West Indian. Perhaps the only real justification needed for a shared juridical jurisdiction like the CCG. When Maori stepped onto Bajan soil, Maori, you know who Maori is, right? The Jamaican who went to Barbados and they stripped her, searched her. She perhaps understood that she had a right to be there. Born out of centuries of slavery and colonialism, when we all of us black peoples were treated as one in a single space of exploitation without borders. Umbilical cord connections deeper than the nation state. This was what the CSME tried, rather feebly, to refashion, and what the courts somewhat belatedly had to acknowledge. The affirmation that the CCJ gave to the binding nature of the CSME treaty arrangements and freedom of a movement in Maori is a formal recognition of this. I think it would be even more of a disaster than Brexit should one of our sovereign nations revoke their CARICOM status. So I see unity arrangements like CARICOM, CSME, and so on as cementing, not undermining, these notions of self-determination in our recognition that we must become more self-sufficient. In terms of property, especially land, we have often interpreted it in very narrow frameworks, not using development as the guide. And that needs to be brought into the discussion of sustainable development and so on. Globally, we've had land grabs by foreign corporations from both the North and the South, and there's a growing consensus of the importance of land rights as a critical cross-cutting enabler. One of the few cases to have addressed this frontally, the question of sovereignty, that is, within the context of economic development and property, is AG and Caterpillar America's company. A case from Guyana concerning the government's decision to convert a state-owned bauxite company to two new companies and replace business debts of the company with bonds. Capital was owned monies and claimed deprivation of property. But the court held that a doctrine of eminent domain, an aspect of sovereignty, authorized the state to acquire private property of citizens for public purposes without constitutional verification. And they talked about a poor economy and so on. We also had cases like Grey Bay, where there was an attempt to set up a McDonald's franchise in Bermuda, but this could never be Trinidad because we're already brainwashed into all American food. And there was a public outcry on the basis that it offended the island's unique identity. So government then passed a law which prohibited restaurants affiliated with foreign restaurants. They wanted to block the move. and they failed to prove a violation of rights. So these were some of the issues where we looked at sovereignty, whether obliquely or not. Having established the existence of sovereignty as a legal principle and a core value that is justiciable in these property development cases, I suggest that the principle can be equally harnessed in those cases where the state attempts to deprive citizens of their sovereignty in developmental projects. As I write, there is a planned land grab in St. Lucia, where a developer has been offered the option of a lease for 99 years of 800 acres of land for a racetrack at $1 per acre per year. The investment is slated to demolish a stadium and a hospital to make way for the racetrack and the horses, and make popular beaches private despite much opposition. Similarly, a well-known hotelier is expected, I was warned not to call names, to occupy prized environmentally sensitive land in Tobago. That same hotelier, you may not know this part, has recently acquired a license to build overwater hotel rooms, thus depriving citizens of access to the beach, again in St. Lucia. These are questions not just for the type of development, but also sovereignty, equality, and environmental rights. The issue of privatizing beaches alone, to me, is one that should get us in a tizzy. So developmental agendas can fuel conflicts with the rule of law just as often as rule of law principles drive development, and it is the judge who has to decide. In St. Lucia, for example, there's an injunction threatened. The smelter case and the Point Fortin Highway are other examples. So although that word sovereignty and self-determination may not have been mentioned, that's really what we were talking about. Which principles in the rule of law should inform a court? These involve not just procedural rights. They involve hardcore substantive rights relating to people's hegemony and their equal place in their own nation state. Imagine, for example, if Parliament were to pass a law that sells the intellectual property rights of our steel plant to a foreign investor. So I think that we need to rethink how we approach these issues with these core values. Perhaps in the smelter case, which did succeed in stopping the proposed aluminum smelter, environmental rights did enter into the value system, the core value system. I have no doubt that the widespread protests helped convince the court that this had emerged as a core value, although cloaked under principle of judicial review. Reflecting on these things, I ask, how would we decide the infamous Collymore and the AG today, that writer strike case, the epitome of the literalistic narrow application of law? Would we believe that a worker is not free to withhold his labor, or that a strike can be equated to a riot? That seems very archaic and an extreme example of simply applying rules of law without cognizance of the rule of law. Seems to me the very antithesis of slavery. You can force a worker to be at a workplace, but you can't compel productivity. And these decisions reinforce the master-servant character of labor laws rooted in inequality. Employment, and I know David Abdullah is going to comment, so I'll leave some of the labor law stuff to him, but we are still viewing employment as entrepreneurship, so that employers ultimately hold the reins of power, as opposed to a notion of work as a necessary element of society in which we all have a stake. We remain comfortable about redundancy law framed within the context of the managerial prerogative. We have even engineered and interpreted laws that immunize foreign employers from paying severance pay, their liabilities. We languish in our complacency when narrow interpretations of labor law result in using the injunction to prevent unions from doing what they need to do in the concept of restraint of trade. That is what we prioritize. And perhaps, though, the strongest examples that we have seen in this notion that economic development must be defined within human rights is with respect to land rights and indigenous peoples. And of course, in Maya Leaders Alliance case is a significant case in that. I wasn't going to say much about this because it's not such a huge issue in the, or I thought it wasn't a huge issue in Trinidad and Tobago. But then when I was writing this, I happened to put on my television, and lo and behold, the spokesman of the Waro peoples, Robina Shaw, was there on television asserting the rights over the San Fernando Hill, one of their sacred places, and to the Banwari man. That was last week, by the way. And he talked about this democracy, the right to property, and his right to dignity. It was very interesting, so I included it. And right now we have the conflict happening in the States as well. Failing all of the exciting possibilities that I have unveiled by applying substantive aspects of the rule of law doctrine, we can always fall back to our comfort zone of judicial review in the administrative law sense, declaring decisions and laws irrational and unreasonable and so on. Even better, we can declare them to be against public policy, the principle that courts embrace when they know something is wrong but they can't put their finger on the why. Note the fascinating case of BCB Holdings and Belize Bank and what the CCJ had to say about the relationship between public policy and the rule of law. The unique power of the legislature to proclaim taxes was found to have been usurped by the executive when it gave tax concessions to a foreign company, and this was deemed a violation of the rule of law. I think that's about sovereignty as well. Taxes, the lifeblood of the country, as US courts have said many times, and certainly about development. The CCJ held that the minister's actions were deeply offensive to public policy, thereby elevating public policy as a possible ground of judicial review. So judicial review has really gotten into these policy considerations, and rightly so, although the judge is always careful not to suggest that her judgment is being substituted for that of the elected policy maker. And it was remarkable, nonetheless, how much power judges have to strike down offending decisions and statutes that they do find offensive in a substantive sense in the rule of law using judicial review, that it's irrational or unreasonable. In HMB, for example, a case from Antigua, the hotel owner delayed repairing their hotel on the best beach in Antigua, and the government stepped in to compulsorily acquire the hotel for a public purpose for developmental reasons. And what was interesting about this case, there was an ouster clause. The legislation, you couldn't review it according to the act. And there was a savings law clause. But the Privy Council said it was not immune from judicial review. It was open to challenge on constitutional grounds as any other decisions which affect the fundamental rights and freedoms of the individual. Very interesting. Also, it was a case where there was an allegation of bias to describe the hotel woman as a white woman who hated black people in Antigua and so forth. Had that been proven, it would have been a due process. But nevertheless, I think judicial review principles give the court considerable leeway to look into the substantive context of law or decisions. So it is naive to suggest that the court is mechanically applying law in this sense. And I wanted to stick to my time, so just to wrap up, I had just had one more point, just to note the development of what was a procedural aspect before protection of the law, which has now morphed into something a bit more substantive in the way it was framed in Mayan Leaders Alliance and subsequent cases. The protection of law can be engaged in the failure of the state to secure enjoyment of constitutional rights. I see that as importing a substantive aspect to the rule of law, using what was hitherto a procedural aspect. So to conclude, our judicial process should not constantly miss the big picture. It must avoid excessive literalism, mechanically applying legal rules. True, we must consider what prevents the approach that I have described from being a form of judicial terrorism. Ultimately, the legislature always has the power to make law, to correct any perceived delinquency on the part of the judges. Certainly, it can result in the kind of cat and mouse games that we have witnessed even in mature democracies. For example, the Labour Party in the UK, whenever they try to bring in progressive labour law legislation, the courts would strike it down. They will do more, they'll strike it down. So we may have some of that. or the basic structure doctrine that I mentioned from India. But surely this is what participatory democracy is about. As a society struggles to define itself, leveraging various voices, including that of the judge, in the end, the people decide. They take notice of judicial squabbles and they force a change of social ethos with the help of CSOs. Even here, the people can make errors. They are not, after all, the voice of God. And they too are allowed to change their minds through referenda or other means, protest. I am not advocating judicial activism, but judicial centeredness. We have become wedded to thinking of law in narrow, rigid prisms, forgetting the origins of our beloved common law, where remedies were carved out on a case-by-case basis to address the evolving needs and problems of the society existing around it. So much so that justice and equity was described as being as variable as a chancellor's foot, if you remember. Anyone can read a constitution, but we require more from judges. Judges should be thought leaders and change agents, not reactionaries, always merely upholding the status quo. They must harness and understand the underlying philosophies and context of the particular society. It is this understanding that is responsible for good law, the rule of law, and ultimately genuine development. The rule of law fuels development, but equally, development must conform to the rule of law in its fullest expression. Thank you.